Welcome to the hottest real estate topics on the planet, keeping you up to date with all the creative ways to buy and sell real estate without bank qualifying, so anyone can build real income starting today. Here is another great show with Dealmaker Bill and Pete the Rookie.
All right, here we are in another episode of Flipping Houses for Rookies.
Good morning. Not again. Oh my God, here we are again. Oh man.
Episode
good morning, everybody.
Episode number 306. The title of today's episode is Pro versus Rookie in Creative Real Estate Exclusively, Part 2.
Well, that's right.
And here's the description. In podcast number 305, which is the podcast before this one, we started a list of good habits or bad habits plus traits that could either make or break you. We covered how most of us have two lives. The one we live, then the unlived life we only think about. And this second life that never really gets played out feeds us a lot of resistance, anxiety, failed purposes, unhappiness, and most often is the core depth of failure. Making these type of thoughts and parts of our mind toxic and dangerous for success. So this continued list is how a pro does more right than wrong for his results. Plus, we matched it up against the rookie habits and traits so you can see the contrast and start making decisions of how you want your future to be. Every sun casts a shadow. And those shadows often deform your spirit of life and stunt your ability, and you may not even know it. This second podcast is designed for you to figure out your shadows and start getting in position to capture the sun. Once you do this, you will be amazed at what could happen in your future. Whoa.
Gee, that's a mouthful.
All right, so a little bit of housekeeping. So in the description of wherever you're watching this podcast or listening to it, you will find a link in there. And I put surprise links in there all the time. So sometimes you find some really cool goodies, and sometimes you find better cool goodies. And the idea is that you can definitely get there and get some help about creative real estate. Because it's all about creative real estate tools and how we use them. And very often it pertains to whatever we're talking about in the podcast. Also, please subscribe to our channel, wherever you're watching us or listening to us. Leave us a review or go to Flipping Houses for Rookies. On the top right-hand side, there's a link for a testimonial. Please leave us a testimonial. And I take good care of those who leave us testimonials, whether they're good or bad. We like the feedback. And lastly, if you have any questions about this podcast, you can go to flippinghousesforrookies.com or about any creative real estate and hit the support ticket, support button on the top right-hand side. And those come directly to me. So I answer all of those a couple times a day. And or you can join us at 9:30-ish Thursday mornings. We actually record this podcast and live stream it on YouTube and on Twitter, as well as Facebook. So you can go on any one of those platforms, Flipping Houses for Rookies, and you could be part of the podcast. You can ask me questions or ask Pete questions, but just be aware that they have to pertain to the podcast because we don't want to distract the podcast. So, all right. And Seamus is here. He says, good morning, gentlemen. Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Here we go. So, Pete, now that we got all that ruckus out of the way, jumping right in podcast 305, we talked about the different habits, traits, and successful habits of the pro and why they make it look so easy. And today we will cover the last few missed in that episode. So if I'm not mistaken, there were five in episode number 305, and I think there's five in episode 306, the habits and traits. Okay.
Yeah, that sounds right. I remember doing five.
But first, let's clear up some basic terms in case someone is listening now and didn't get them from podcast number 305. So a professional, or pro, as we call it, doesn't mean a doctor, lawyer, or someone in a profession, right? Like has a license or something like that. Although we can talk about them like that. But what I mean by a pro is a person is in an ideal state or frame of behavior while working for minimum results. And if things go sideways, the pro knows how to respond to get things back on track. So the pro doesn't necessarily have to have experience, but it helps. Okay. So the pro just knows how to move around. They're familiar with the territory. They know where they're going, and they know how to move around. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay. The amateur, on the other hand, is a person who pursues the activity as a hobby or a minor occupation. In other words, it's plan B for them, and they're hoping that it can replace plan A. So plan A would be your survival, how you make money now, how you create income, your lifestyle, everything is there, and you don't, pardon my French, have the balls to disturb that.
Yeah.
So you stay an amateur. You're not willing to jeopardize plan A. So plan B is being an amateur, which means amateurs are self-taught on rules and the DIYs, do-it-yourself stuff, on getting experience. Experience is where you learn the exceptions. And that's always where the money is. So I've been saying a lot lately, if you read my emails or whatever, the last couple months, like learning is for the rules. Experience is for the exceptions. So just as an example of that, an exception would be, and you were teasing me about this for a while, there's seven core strategies here on Bill Splitter, right? So if you just learn those seven strategies of how to purchase real estate and sell it too, it doesn't have to just be on the acquisition. It could be on the selling side as well, right? You would have an arsenal of tools that most people don't have, unless they're a creative real estate investor. It's not really a creative real estate investor. It's creative real estate financing. And I've been on a binge. I don't know if you read my emails, but I've been on a binge lately with this because technically, as much as I hate to talk about this, and I've avoided it for years, I've just gone head on, head down, full force into the crowd with, you know what? All the money's in the paperwork. We're not really buying and selling real estate. We're buying and selling documents, if you think about it.
Yeah.
Right.
It's not as, Bill, it's not as sexy as the nice pretty houses, though. Sorry. That's the problem, huh?
Totally. So here's what happens. Amateurs can't spend money or use resources to become a pro because they think they need to overcome fear. Right? When the pro knows that fear is always there and he just needs to confront it.
Yeah.
So the amateur's afraid of doing things, including kicking plan A out, saying no more of you. I'm not, you know, fire my boss or do something. You know, this is kind of like somebody that wants to lose 50 pounds and they decide that I am going to get up at 5 o'clock in the morning and go to the gym. Like do something, right? Like make a plan. And what is the saying we used to say?
Any plan followed is better than no plan at all.
Yeah, no, it was.
That's the military one.
Yeah, it was plan the work and then work the plan.
Oh, that's a good one. I love when they would play on words like that. We take the same words And it kind of either means the opposite or totally enhanced. Say it again. I like that one.
Plan the work and then work the plan.
Yeah, that's great.
Right. So the amateur is not a derogatory term. It's just, what is your intention? What is it that you want? Now, I've been kind of like doing some self-help stuff lately. This is the time of the year I kind of mentally struggle. I don't know why, but I kind of struggle. I get into June and July, and I kind of go through some stuff, some personal stuff every year. And I decided this year I'm not doing it. I'm kicking it out.
I'm with you. I'm with you, Bill.
That reactive shit isn't going to hit me again. So right. Anyways, the point is, you know, it surprises me. You would think I would know this because for 30 years I've been studying this stuff. But I was just reading, what is it called? Earl Nightingale has a thing called The Strangest Secret.
Oh boy, not just the secret, the strangest secret. Earl.
And you could get it online. Just type in Earl Nightingale, Strangest Secret. I mean, it's like a 9 or 10 page document, and it is phenomenal.
It's a document, not a whole
book. It's not a book. Well, what happened was he actually, I think he owned an insurance company or something. I don't remember what it was in the 50s. And he motivated his staff with this kind of stuff. So this is in the early 50s, and he had to go somewhere or do something. And so he had this talk with his staff before he left. And that's kind of how it started. And then it's turned into this whole thing, you know, 70 something years later. So the point is that, you know, he talks about, he does a great job of making an analogy of a farmer planting seeds.
Yeah.
And the land doesn't know what kind of seed it is.
Nope.
So it could be corn, or he says it could be nightshade, and nightshade is a poisonous plant, kind of like poison ivy. Mm-hmm. So he's like, it will nourish that seed, it will grow it, and if the sun and the nourishment in the soil and you water it, the nightshade will grow just as good as the corn.
Yeah.
So it's like the good and the evil, right? So he uses that analogy about your mind. Like, you plant a seed in your mind and it will nourish it, whether it's good or bad. Like, I am going to do real estate, or how the heck am I going to do real estate, right? Yeah. Those are the difference between the corn and the nightshade, right? So he does a really good analogy of that. And that's just one little section of it. He talks about goals in there. And, you know, he talks about a ship, you know, a cargo ship that has people on it, and 99.99% of the time it'll get to this destination. And then he talks about, what if the ship doesn't know where it's going? You know, so, you know,
lives like that. There's people like that. They don't really going.
It's a really good short read. I mean, literally, it's something you could read in 20 or 30 minutes. I mean, I read it often. So.
And what's the name of the document?
It's called The Strangest Secret.
The Strangest Secret.
Just Google it and you'll find it. I think it's a 9 or 10 page. Actually, it's probably not even that long. There's whoever prints it talks about the author for 1 or 2 pages. So it's less than 9 or 10 pages. So
cool.
But the point is that's what the amateur doesn't know. They don't know this inner strength that they have. They don't believe in themselves. They're not sure. They have this fear factor that they feel like they have to try to overcome that fear before they could be a pro. They think a pro doesn't have fear, right?
No,
and they think that the pro has handled it, when really what's happened is the pro has the fear. They just manage it better, right?
Sure. You know, you talk about courage. Courage is not having fear. Courage is you're afraid, but you do it anyways.
Yeah.
And that's why you get a medal.
Yeah.
Because you did it in spite of that.
Yeah.
That's why you get the medal.
That's true,
Pete. All right.
So bottom line, pros make money at their activity to support their lifestyle. Right?
Mm-hmm.
That they're in. So not only do they make money to improve or make their lifestyle, but they make enough money for the activity to support it. So, you know, and this is not about coaching, but I hear about this all the time. Like, I'm going to go find a deal and then I'm going to hire you as a coach, Bill. And out of seven years this stint, and I did it in early 2000s and heard the same thing. So I probably got 15 years worth of coaching under my belt, right? Yeah. Never thought of that till just now, but I've never once had one of those people come back.
No, it's like a doctor wants to get some patients, then he'll learn how to be a doctor.
Yeah.
Like, I don't think so.
Yeah. So unfortunately, what happens is the amateur can't spot a deal. They don't know what they don't know. They miss things. You know, things could be right under their nose and they don't even see it. I mean, we do that in a coaching group. I mean, sometimes it even happens to me. We'll be talking about a deal and it'll be 15 minutes in before I'm like, you know what? Maybe we could do this. Because mm-hmm. for 15 minutes, I missed it. Mm-hmm. You know, I didn't think it was a deal. And then 15 minutes later, it pops in my head like, oh, wait a minute. One time I did this. Let's try that.
That's right.
You know? So it's not necessarily the me being the mentor. It's the group environment. It's the mastermind process of being around those people that just enhance the pro to be better. Right. Mm-hmm. So it's a great environment. So the amateur doesn't make money because they're not emotionally all in, like we're talking about. And they don't believe in themselves enough to go pro and get the big gains. Right?
Yep. Yeah, that's right. Unfortunately.
All right. So let's move on. In podcast number 305, we covered five traits, like I said. So I'm going to start with number six now.
Okay.
So here we go.
Lay it on us.
Number six, a pro sees order. He or she feels if there is disorder, something may get missed.
Hmm.
He or she is on a mission. So every little thing counts, and searching for what is missing is a waste of time. So the most common thing that happens is if you don't have a good way to keep track of your leads, and they're disorganized, the pro knows that he's wasting time or she's wasting time looking for a lead when they could just be talking to somebody.
True, very true.
Another thing that could happen is if you don't keep your written offers organized, and somebody calls you back 3 months later, mm-hmm. and you can't find the offer. Yeah. And they're like, I'm ready to do it, which happens a lot. Right? So the pro knows that time looking for that lost document or that unfound lead or, you know, and I'm even going through this myself because we're doing right now with the coaching group, I've been doing 3 or 4 times a week, I do live closing calls. So I've been doing my calls that I do for my business, for you and I and for Sean and I, right? Mm-hmm. I spend about 60 or 90 minutes a day with a Zoom call, and my coaching clients are able to come onto that Zoom call and watch me and listen. They watch what I look at before I make the call. They look, you know, the information I need before I make the call.
Yeah.
Then I push the button and make the call, and they're all muted in the background just listening to me talk to that person.
Right? Yeah.
And then when I'm done, they'll ask whatever questions for a couple minutes, and then I'll make another call. Right. But the point is that I even have like a notebook. I went and bought an 89 cent notebook, which is not 89 cents now. It's $18. I'm being a
joke. Ouch.
A little shot at Biden there. So the point is that I just have a notebook, and every single day I just keep track of it. And now I just go through the notebook. And there's leads, and honestly, if I hadn't written them in that notebook, I would have missed them. I had a couple I was calling for you yesterday. I talked to them last week, totally forgot about it, and I called and left messages. And I have to tell you, in today's environment, so we're in June of 2022, okay? In today's environment, it's changing. I mean, I'm on calls with these people, and I'll look in our software, and it'll say 3 months ago or 4 months ago that I think the example I used last week was there was a house that was on there was it says the Zestimate was 224.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this was 3 or 4 months ago. So I go on Zillow now and it says it's $199. And oh, yeah, by the way, the guy says he's got it under contract for $176. Mm. My software says he was asking, he was steadfast. In other words, he was hard-nosed at $215.
Yeah, 3 months ago.
So when I say time changes everything, that's exactly what I'm talking about. And unfortunately, I don't know. I mean, I do know why this is, but it's sad, actually, because it happens in the stock market, too. Things change in my world because I'm totally on the front lines. I'm, like, right on the front lines. And so are you. And so is Sean, right? We're on the front lines. We see what's happening. But by the time it gets all the way back to the general, we're like that was days ago, right? So what happens with real estate is it's months later. It's 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 months later. And a lot of times they just don't want to believe what we're telling them. So they'll go put their property on the market and have to find out for themselves that that's really what happened. Mm-hmm. So that's why time changes everything. So I believe that those adjustments happened the beginning of this year. I believe the spring market was not a spring market, not like it has been in the past. And I believe those adjustments are coming around. And I also believe by the time we get to the end of the summer of 2022, at least in Connecticut or in Akron, Ohio, which is where we are, the market is not only going to be soft, but we're going to have people begging us to buy houses from them. I could be very wrong. I've made statements like this before and they got close and then they reverted. You know, like President Trump getting elected was one of them. You know, that was a total aberration, you know, where the market just kind of was doing really bad and it was going the way I thought it was going to go. And then he got elected and literally a month later, it was all different.
Yeah.
So who knows, but that's what my prediction is. So what I'm saying is the amateur's not willing to ride these waves where the pro will figure out what to do and how to make it work, you know? So the interesting thing to me, Peter, is, and I feel like I'm talking way too much this morning, but the interesting thing to me is this. I remember when I was first in business, I owned a gas station. 23 years old, I bought a gas station. I paid $43,000 for it. I went to the bank because of my father-in-law at the time, and he co-signed a loan for me.
Yeah.
I lost my train of thought.
You're talking about markets changing and how.
Oh, yes. Okay. Thank you. So I had this gas station for a while and some years later, you know, maybe 10 years later, I run this thing and I'm completely got blindfolds on. I never owned a business before. I'm 23 years old, you know, ups and downs, getting whacked. You know, I wasn't very good at reading and writing, you know, so I would get into contracts. I had no idea what they were. All this kind of weird stuff. Right. Now I have a partner. I took on a partner. Because we're buying and selling cars now, right? Mm-hmm. And he says to me one day while we're having lunch, he's like, because I had this concept that I was going to hit like this plateau. And I was going to be like, the money's going to be coming in and I'm going to be sitting back with my feet up on the desk and I'm not going to have to worry about it.
Oh, that'd be nice.
Right? Much like what our real estate people think about, right?
Yeah.
And he said to me, if that's the case, you're in trouble. What are you talking about? He's like, with a business, you have a problem every week. There's problems every week. Your job is to resolve them and get new problems next week. And it was a total.
Bill, how old, this was, I know who you're talking about. Tell people how old he was.
Well, he was probably 70, 65 or 70.
So he had
owned three new car dealerships, one of which is a Toyota dealership, and they sold 250 cars a month. So he had a lot of staff. He had a lot of experience. He had a lot of, you know, he owned real estate, you know, commercial real estate. Him and I did a lot of deals together. I think when 2008, 2009 hit, we still had 28 houses together or something like that, you know, stuff that I had to go fix. So the point is that you never really have it so it's fixed. Like, for example, I just got a phone call from a tenant yesterday. I just renovated an apartment that I have. I spent $8,000 renovating it, right? Which mm-hmm. was not exactly what I wanted to do because I didn't want to, I didn't have the $8,000 to use. I had to go find, I had to go take it out of places I didn't want to take it from, right? And because COVID, because I used up a lot of cash through COVID. And the point is that I put these people in there. They've been there 3 months. And she called me yesterday and says that her husband can't handle the stairs and they're going to move. Now, my leases, the way I write my leases for my tenants, not for my lease option people. My leases are for 3 months and then they go month to month.
Oh, why do you do that?
Because the attorney told me it's better that way. It's better for eviction. Yeah, it's better for eviction because you don't have a 12-month lease. So my point is that here I was thinking that I was all set for a year and I was just going to collect this $1,370, bing, bang, boom, and nope. So now I paid my realtor to find them. So I paid him $1,370. So I took the deposit money he gave them. So now I got to go find it. You know, it's like this whole, it's just so I'm not saying that, you know, times aren't good and I work less. There are those times too. The point that I'm making is that this is not a type of business where you just go on vacation and sail around the world and you don't have to worry and you just check your bank account and it shows up. You have to work. I mean, Kiyosaki said, and I'm off on a tangent, I'll get back here in a minute, but Kiyosaki said that the definition of wealth is if your assets, the yield, in other words, the profit from your assets, exceeds your monthly outgo, then you're wealthy. In other words, if you need to live off of $4,000 a month and your assets, whether it's stocks or real estate or a business or whatever it is, can produce, we'll say $6,000 and you only need $4,000, that's good. But what makes you wealthy is how many hours a month you have to work for that $6,000. So what I would say is, you know, with real estate, something with those kind of numbers, if you work 8 or 10 hours a month, you're good, right? So it's not just not working at all. It's working the least amount, but you still have to work. You still have to solve problems. You're going to be the only one in your business that will have the finger on the pulse. And what I mean by that is you'll want your finger on the pulse with the checkbook and the marketing, right? And the expenses, obviously. Mm-hmm. So and which is the checkbook. So that takes work. So sorry, I got off on a little tangent there, but you know, it's the difference between the pro and the amateur, because the amateur thinks that they could just hit that plateau and it stops.
Like, but you know what it sounds like? It's like this is very relevant to today's culture. It sounds like people are trying to do real estate so they don't have to work, rather than being willing to work to make it work so it's very profitable. And at least you're your own boss and you don't have to do 40 hours a week, but it's not like how to get out of living.
Right.
You know,
it's just a different lifestyle. It's a different lifestyle. I mean, you think about this, cause I've gone through this gamut too with others. And again, this is not part of our script today, but you know, the stock market, you could do that with the stock market, put money in and just collect your checks. But here's the thing. Let's take a look at that for a second. Yeah. Let's say I put $5,000 in the stock market today. Mm-hmm. First thing that has to happen is that $5,000 has to stay there. Right?
Yeah.
Second thing that happens is it could go up and down. It's volatile. You know, one news story, one storm, one pandemic can change that. Right?
Yep.
Now watch, if I do the same thing in real estate, I take the same $5,000 and I buy a piece of property, the thing that happens is in the stock market, my $5,000 is worth $5,000. Mm-hmm. If I buy real estate, my $5,000 now turns into $100,000 because the $5,000 was a deposit and I bought a $100,000 house.
That's right. That's
the first thing that happens. Second thing that happens is if I want to take the $5,000 out, I can refinance it. I can take the $5,000 out and I still own the asset that's performing. And number three, even though real estate is volatile, and I understand that, but when you're renting and you're doing the things like we do, rent-to-own stuff, that stuff is not. You know, rents have been, I mean, they go up and down, but you're not going to lose everything because of rents. Right. So, you know, people say, well, maybe you'll have vacancies. Well, the reason why you have vacancies is usually because you're not taking care of the properties. You know, if you do a good job of taking care of the properties, like today, after today's podcast, I have to go over and look at somebody's apartment because I've sent somebody there to fix something and they keep saying it's not fixed. So I got to go lay my own eyes on it and make a decision. That's what my job is, to make the decision. Right. So, but I'm coming there, you know, it's like, you know, I take care of it. I'm not going to ignore them. I'm not a slumlord. You know what I mean? Sure. So when you give people good opportunities, they will come. Rent to own is a good opportunity.
Yeah. I don't think we're running out of people in this country.
Yeah.
I don't think they're running out the boundaries, you know?
Right. So the amateur, we're back on being organized, right?
Mm-hmm.
So the pro likes to be amateur. The pro likes to be organized, right? So the pro knows that when he's organized, he eliminates chaos in his environment, so it doesn't affect his or her thinking and or activity. Now, a lot of people, that's one of the things that, matter of fact, I think I'll read it to you. Earl Nightingale. I'm going back to that. Okay. And I'm sorry for doing this today. It's just something that.
I figure we get to hear what you're reading every week.
Yeah.
Yeah. Didn't you think of having a series or we just would talk about books? We would take a book and he'd give all the information in it.
Yeah. Right.
Book reviews. Right. Yeah.
So he says this, he says, the human mind is far more fertile, far more incredible and mysterious than the land, because he's talking about the plant and the farmer, but works the same way. It doesn't care what we plant, success or failure, and a concrete worthwhile goal or confusion, misunderstanding, fear, anxiety, and so on. But what we plant, it must return to us. Then here's the point that I want to make, and it's the same way. It's exactly where we are in the podcast, right? The problem is that our mind comes as standard equipment at birth. It's free. Mm-hmm. And things that are given to us for nothing, we place little value on.
Jeez, that's funny.
Little value on. Things that we pay money for, we value. The paradox is that exactly the reverse is true. Everything that's really worthwhile in life came to us free. Our minds, our souls, our bodies, our hopes, our dreams, our ambitions, our intelligence.
Oh, that's crazy.
Our love of family and children and friends and country, all these priceless possessions are free. But the things that cost us money are actually very cheap and can be replaced at any time. A good man can be completely wiped out and make another fortune. He can do that several times. Even if our home burns down, we can rebuild it. But the things we got for nothing, we can never replace.
That is incredible. I've never heard anything like that.
Yeah.
That's in the Strangest Secret reference again. I'm gonna go read that.
Well, send me an email and I'll send it to you. But the point is that's the difference. That's the difference between the pro and the amateur. The pro knows that he has these assets and he can use them. The amateur thinks he's missing them. Right?
Takes it for granted.
Yeah.
Really?
The amateur, on the other hand, has not gotten up to understanding what is important and what isn't. They think all information and rules are important.
Mm.
So they never get things organized because of this. They have a lack of results and are consistently chasing new shiny objects, looking for this organization. They are mostly dispersed, which means they're scattered.
Yeah.
Can't think correctly and often have wrong targets. All right, let's move on to number seven. We spent way too much time on number six.
It's like those scavenger hunts. I was trying to remember. Like a scavenger hunt. They're looking for the magic to find the pot of gold. Yeah, boy.
All right, number seven.
Seven.
A pro does not show off. His or her work has a style.
Mm-hmm.
It is often distinctly his or her own. And you know it when you see it.
That is interesting.
That's why I call Bill's Planet. It's my distinct style, right?
Yeah.
His or her style serves the greater mission and everyone involved. These habits of behavior are not meant to drain attention. I'm sorry, it's draw attention. I can't read my own writing. These habits of behavior are not meant to draw attention to the pro. He doesn't like that, or she doesn't like that. But if there's attention drawn, it is to the overall mission and cause or to the group.
Yeah.
It's like flipping houses for rookies. It's about the group, especially my coaching group. I mean, look how I coddle that group.
Mm.
Look how I make sure, first of all, who comes in and who goes out and what they get while they're there. Right? Oh, there he is. Johnny Cash has just showed up.
Morning, Cashflow.
He calls himself Johnny Cashflow.
That's cool.
He said, howdy, real estate freaks.
Yeah.
Anyways, so these habits of behavior are not meant to draw attention to the pro, but if there is attention drawn, it is to the overall mission and group. Okay. The amateur, on the other hand, has a mindset or kind of like a mono mission.
Like, right? Mono, like self?
Yeah. It's just about himself or herself. Like, I need to make 20 grand. What's the fastest way to do this?
You know, if there's anything that turns you off, it's the person that's only out for himself.
Yeah.
And people can smell that a mile away.
And they don't even know that. They don't know that they're doing this.
Oh, but they don't see anybody but themselves. So how would they know?
Well, it's not even themselves. They just see the problem and they feel the pressure it has on them. They need 20 grand because if not, my daughter's going to get kicked out of college, or I need 20 grand to pay my taxes, or, right? It's something like that.
Mm-hmm.
Thinking, now here's what happens, because it's a mono mission, right?
M-O-N-O.
Yeah, mono, single mission, right?
Yeah.
Thinking they can shortcut the experience and can fake it until they make it, tend to try and show off with their clients. All under the think that the client will be impressed and give them the deal. It never works, by the way. Fake always rears its ugly head when you don't want it. So The best advice that I think I can give anybody, Peter, anybody, and I've given this to my kids and to you and to myself, right?
Yeah.
Look, don't listen. And what that means is your words have to match your actions. That's how people trust you.
Mm-hmm.
So when you're faking it and you can't perform, then people right away think you're a scam, especially nowadays. They think you're a scam.
Oh, yeah.
Or they think that you're doing something wrong, or that you're trying to pull the wool over on them, right? Like think of it this way. If you go into a used car lot and the guy kind of slithers over to you, the salesman,
he slithers. Right?
And I know this because I did this for 25 years. I was in.
You've been there. I bought cars from you.
Yeah, but I didn't run my dealership that way. But my point is that what's happening in that relationship between you and that guy? And what's happening when you dissect it is that the salesman is trying to sell you something based on his interest, his goals, his rewards, and his whatever he needs.
Yep.
Not yours. and you feel betrayed because he wasn't looking out for you. So you may end up with a car that's a lemon, or you pay too much, or instead of getting, you know, 6% interest, you get 9% interest. There's something he did to help him, not you, right? Which is why a used car salesman has that reputation, because that's what it was all through the 60s and, well, mostly the 70s, 80s, and 90s, right? Mm-hmm. Nowadays, it's different because the manufacturers control the dealerships much more. But the point is that when you're working with someone, it's not the fake it till you make it. It's not the impression you leave. It's not giving them a seminar. It's not showing off what you think they think you know. Right? It's not impressing them that does that. Right? What does it is the sincerity and the fact that your words match your actions. And that's what I mean by a pro doesn't show off. They just casually and nonchalantly just do as they say they're going to do. Well, how about if I do this? Why, can you do that? Yeah, I'll tell you what. Let me call so-and-so, and I'll call you back tomorrow and see if I can pull it off. Mm-hmm. And I call back tomorrow, and I say, I can't pull it off, and here's the reason why.
Yeah.
They respect me. Or I pulled it off. This is amazing. I can't believe you did it.
Well, they're going to trust you more when you do that. When you BS them, they're not going to. You can see through that a mile. It's much better to be honest. Like I don't know. Let me check with somebody. I'll get back to you. And they appreciate that you're working at it.
Right. So that's what my point is that when I say the pro, the amateurs think they can shortcut the experience. Hmm. Now, this statement that I've been making, until you test it, use it, maybe even work with me or see it in place, it won't be as profound as it should be. Mm-hmm. But when I say learning is for rules and experience is about the exceptions.
Yeah.
Now you're around me all the time and you'll say to me, well, that's not exactly the way the formula goes. You blended two formulas together. Mm-hmm. You know, like I'll give you an example. It's a free and clear house.
Yep.
Person wants all their money.
Hmm.
So instead of pitching to them doing owner financing and trying to go up against their resistance of doing owner financing, I flip the table around and I go on their side of the table and fit in their shoes and say, okay, if I was this seller and wanted to get that much cash, how would I get it? This is what I'm talking about. I flip the deal. So what I tell them is, well, how about if you go get a mortgage, you grab all that cash and leave me with the payments? So mm-hmm. I just took it from a free and clear to a subject to deal.
Yeah. On a free and clear house that doesn't have a mortgage, you made one up.
I made a subject to deal out of it so they can get their cash. Right. Yeah,
that's what they want.
That's what I mean by the exceptions. The experience is for exceptions. Mm-hmm. Right. So that's
what when you teach them, you can't teach everything possible that would happen. So you got to show mainly here's how it goes. But life doesn't just follow the rules. It does all quirky kind of things. And if you know your tools, I mean, I had a hammer, a nail in the other day, and the nail was like a half an inch short. I couldn't hold it with my fingers and hit it with the hammer without smashing my fingers. And I like to play my guitar. So I took a little needle nose plier. I held the nail. Then I hit it with the hammer and I saved my fingers and I got it in. You know, where's that in the rule book? You know, it's stupid, but that's how it turned out to be. It's tools.
It's experience,
And I didn't smash my finger.
All right, moving on. Number eight. Good job for not smashing your finger. Number eight. A pro doesn't hesitate to ask for help.
Exactly.
Tiger Woods is considered one of the greatest golfers, yet he works with Butch Harmon, who's a coach.
Well, you know, it wouldn't be a secret. I never heard the guy. Cool.
Actually, I said that wrong.
What?
Tiger doesn't work with Butch. He reveals. He revels in the help. He basks in the help. He wants the help. right? He never feels instruction has to be suffered through. Right? A pro knows the numbers, knows the number of times over, or the repetitious practice makes a natural activity.
Yeah.
Right?
You know what's weird to me? What you just said that? I just got this picture of somebody like Tiger Woods, who's really good, being open to getting help and listening to somebody, which is probably why he's good. He didn't start out good. He listened and took the advice. How many people do we all know who will not listen to anybody's advice?
Right.
But they'll dish it out in their poverty.
Well, it goes back to the earlier ones. You don't show off. You know, you're
humble in a way.
Yeah.
You're humble in a way. You're willing to learn. You know, as an educator, you know, the first step of learning, you know this because we've studied some good educational materials. The first step of learning is being open to it. If you think you know everything already, I don't need. I have a friend.
It's the other way around. The first barrier to study is thinking you already know it.
Yeah, and right. So you have to have an open mind to do it, to be willing. I have some. I told you this a couple of years ago. You got one of somebody I know. I do real estate. Well, and I told him like read some books, come to a lake. Oh no! I want to learn it all by myself. Like what?
Yeah, I've had people tell me I like the challenge of trying to figure it out.
Oh my God. You just destroyed the entire purpose of education where somebody spends their life learning something and writes it in a book. You can learn it in an hour or two. Instead, you want to take 10 years to not learn it and screw up and go broke. Good luck.
They want to reinvent the wheel. Like, why do that, right?
Dumb.
All right. So the pro knows that he can't see himself all the time.
Say that again.
The pro knows he can't see himself or herself all the time.
Mm-hmm.
And that the coach or mentor's job is to help him see.
Yeah.
Like with Tiger Woods, you know, his coach, right?
Mm-hmm.
Who is, I forget his name, Butch Harmon, right? shows him where to tweak his swing.
Yeah.
Right. Without that, you can't see it. I mean, I have a coach just for that reason. And he asks me all the time, like, what can I do for you, Bill? I don't feel like I'm doing enough for you. I feel like I'm like, just listening to me once a week is good. Just so I can say it out loud because I don't know anybody else to talk to.
Mm-hmm.
Right? 'Cause I don't talk to my wife or my kids, or sometimes I don't talk to, like with you, I don't talk to you about all the online stuff and the glitches and partnerships and lawyers. And it's just letting me it's a this, it's a that, it's a this, it's a that, you know, all day for a couple hours is worth it.
Right? Yeah. 'Cause you'll figure it out if you get to talk it out. But if you're just talking in your head, you'll go in circles.
Yeah. The amateur doesn't have, and excuse me. Wow. The amateur doesn't have any of this. He thinks of help as a monetary expense.
Ooh.
And tries to use math to justify it.
Yeah. With a lot of ifs thrown in, I'll bet you. If. Yeah.
When it really comes down to, has the amateur decided to go pro no matter what?
Yeah.
Then and only then can he or she seek help, because they need to revel in it. They need to appreciate it. You know, I've paid tens of thousands of dollars for coaching and gotten one lesson out of it and figured it was worth it.
Well, it depends on what you get back, doesn't it?
We're going next week. We're going next week to a seminar for 3 days.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I said to you, I was bitching about the other day. I said, this son of a bitch is getting expensive because the fly and renting cars. And I mean, the hotel room's $400 a night.
Well, not that bad, but they're trying to charge us that.
We're not paying it.
Well, it's on the beach. So it's like just shy of two, which, you know, it's not a fancy hotel. And then like, hey, I need another night. We have a Comfort Inn 2 miles away. It's only $400 a night. Yeah. And it's on the ocean. Like, no, thank you. So why are we doing it, Bill?
Yeah, because all I need is one thing and it pays for it all.
Yeah.
Because I always need help. Everybody needs help. One new idea.
Well, you know, there's
and there's connections and connections.
Yes. And he's a good connect and he has good connections. There's one good reason why things you always have to keep your eye on things. Things change. It's not like you don't know something. You can know everything about a subject, and then tomorrow something changes and you have to keep moving ahead. Know how I learned it? I was at kind of a business thing, and they said, stay in present time. Like, what do you mean stay in present time? Because you hear people say, well, gee, the car worked yesterday. Right. Well, gee, this worked last year. Yeah. I don't know. We're it's sending letters out.
It always worked this way. It's not doing that now.
That's right. So in present time, the world changes, life changes. One day we didn't have electricity, next day we did. You know, things change. So you have to keep your eyes open.
All right, good. Number 9, a pro does not take failure or success personally.
Hmm.
The pro has learned he or she cannot take rejection personally because it only opens the door to resistance.
Hmm.
And resistance is your compass. It tells the pro where to go or where not to go.
Can you explain that a little more?
Well, I can tell you when I have an idea, mm-hmm. and I'm like, I'll talk to you, and I'll talk to this one, I'll talk to that one. And especially like I'll talk to my kids, or I'll talk to my wife, or I'll talk to people that are not in the industry, and they'll tell me I'm nuts for doing that. I'll run face first right into it because I know it'll work. I mean, Dan Kennedy says do the opposite of the herd.
Yeah, yeah.
That's resistance. So I know where to go, where not to go.
Bill, I can't even find the herd. I'm so off the herd. But for better or for worse, and it's not always for better, but what the hell?
The pro loves their work and is tough-minded in the face of indifference. In fact, criticism is a way the pro learns what is acceptable and what is not. The criticism is just places to look that he or she may not have seen before. Now, the amateur has not taken the game or the mission seriously enough yet. So criticism and resistance is taken personally without a true to die for purpose. The amateur isn't living life. Life is living him.
Mm-hmm.
I was up early this morning for whatever reason. It's something new that I've been doing. And I like get up at like 4:30 now for whatever reason. So I turned the TV on, and God knows why, how these things show up on my TV. You know, we have internet TV, you know, and it was How I Made My First Million or something, some documentary. And they were talking about like Goodyear.
Uh-huh.
Now, unbeknownst to me, I didn't know this. Goodyear was in the early 1800s. He's the one that made rubber flexible. Prior to that, rubber would come out of trees, and when it got warm, it was soft, and when it got cold, it snapped.
Oh, that hard, brittle.
This guy went 6 years of his life and used his life savings, and his wife and kids had to live in a factory with him because he spent all his money trying to make rubber flexible.
Wow.
He changed the world because look how rubber is now. And unbeknownst to me, that when the tire company, Goodyear Tire, was formed in the early 1900s, they used his name out of respect for the rubber. I didn't know that. The point that I'm making is that this show, there were multiple others. There was one about a guy that, not the Wright brothers, but he was the first one to fly a plane from one major city to another major city. Mm-hmm. The point is that they're in the mission. It's the greatest good for the greatest number involved, their mission.
Yeah.
Right? So the mission is where their head is at. Right. So all the other stuff is just noise.
Well, it's incredible that people can see something that doesn't exist and make it happen. Like, you know, rubber becomes brittle. It's not soft. Well, I'm going to try to make it. Well, it isn't. And you just kept at it for years.
Right.
And like, you know, buying a house, we can't buy the house. You know, we've bought houses, no money down, you know, no money out of our pockets, and made money. And like, I read about that years ago in a book. I'm thinking, well, wouldn't that be great? And I've done it now, and it actually works. But you're making something out of nothing. It's amazing because you know what you're doing.
Been talking about that in emails lately. Johnny Cash, I see your email. Yes, a support ticket would be great. All right, so the amateur is not taking the game or the mission seriously enough yet. So criticism and resistance is taken personally without a true to die for a purpose. The amateur isn't living life. Life is living him or her.
Yeah.
Without these thoughts of conviction, worthy of everything short of death, all his thoughts are confusing. So without the goal and without the mission, it's confusing. They blow with the wind. There's no anchor. So I was going to see if I could find this section in Earl Nightingale's thing. I should probably use this to write this podcast, but I didn't even think of it.
I think you are using it.
Well, I am now.
Yeah. These people are so interesting. They were 100 years ago, 200 years ago, and they just incredible things.
Yeah, well, that's called evolution. That's why we are where we are, right?
Yeah, but we forget. I mean, rubber actually was softened up that far back.
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
The early 1800s.
Yeah.
So we're almost at the hour, so I don't have time to look for this. So let's move on. So because of no mission or goal, he thinks of nothing and becomes nothing.
Oof.
Lastly, number 10, a pro recognizes their limitations. My old man used to tell me all the time, every good man knows his limitations. It cracks me up, actually. So many amateurs will get stuck on doing paperwork for their deals when all you need to do is just one deal. In other words, they won't go forward because they think they need all this magical paperwork and they can't do it because they don't have the paperwork, right? When all you need to do is just one deal, right? Let the deal pay for a lawyer to do the docs. Now you have this template for the rest of all your deals.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying? So it's like, so, you know, the point is a pro recognizes their limitations, right? So just, we talked about this in many episodes before, the gain, what was it? The gain and the gap in the gain. Anyways. Finding somebody else to do it for you, right?
Oh, yeah. Well, one of the things that helped me the most when I was trying to learn this and feeling like insecure, unsure of myself was when you said something like, it's okay not to know. You just go ask somebody and just tell them like, well, I don't have the answer to that one. I haven't run into that yet. I will go I got a plumber I know, and I'll find out, let you know. And that just took so much pressure off. You don't have to know everything because you can't.
Right.
And it's okay not to look like you know everything, because that's a know-it-all, phony baloney. Go ask. That helped me so much. That would be, to me, on your number 1 to 10, that'd be number 1 for me personally. And I think that helped a lot of people. Don't forget that one, folks. That's important.
Yeah. So when you use professional agents, and when I mean agents, I don't mean real estate agents, but when you use professional agents that know their craft, they end up teaching you and you teach them. We all have our own ability. Lawyers know law, not how to make deals.
Yeah.
Realtors know how to find buyers, usually, but they don't know creative real estate structuring.
Nope.
The amateur thinks they need to know it all, mostly so they don't look stupid in front of others. So they get paralysis of analysis, or analysis of paralysis, or whichever way it goes, from trying to learn what they don't need to know. No, this is my final punchline, and then we're going to go.
Yeah.
The pro works with senior data that gets things done. The amateur doesn't know there is senior data that gets things done.
Mm-hmm.
And tries to learn all of the information and data and gets overwhelmed. A good example of this is when you don't know what to do with a seller, you just ask them, what would have to happen for me to buy your house today? That's the senior data.
Yeah.
Man, no studying scripts, mm-hmm. learning for 15 decades. The answers to this question is the seller's data, and it's the senior data. And is what you need to do to make the deal. Just that simple. What would have to happen for me to buy your house today? And then match it to one of the seven deals. But the point is that the amateur doesn't know their senior data. And this goes back to learning is for the rules and experience is for the exceptions.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So if you have senior datums, like for example, if I'm doing, if somebody wants me to do a renovation,
mm-hmm.
my house needs work and they want me to buy a house and they want me to pay cash. Here's the senior data. It's about 50% of the ARV. That's my offer.
Yeah.
So if I'm looking at a house and it's a $200,000 house and I'm online and it says it's worth $199,000 and the person says they want all cash and it needs renovation, I'm going to say mm-hmm. to them, so you're willing to sell for like low 100s? What do you mean? Like, I don't know, 100, 105, 108, something like that. I don't need to do the math. I don't need to do anything. I just made an offer. The senior datum is that if you do the Mayo formula, maximum allowable offer formula, which is ARV after renovated value times 70% minus the repairs, it will always come out to be between 45 and 55% of the ARV. Always. Mm-hmm. It's just the way mm-hmm. the math works. Mm-hmm. And when you do that dozens and dozens of times, you'll start to see it. So now if they say yes, so what's your real offer? Now I'll do the formula. But I'm just throwing it out there and testing them on would they? Will they? Could they? Should they?
Mm-hmm.
Maybe they might.
Sure.
So the senior datum is all I need to know is what would have to happen for me to buy your house today? Oh, well, you have to give me all cash. Okay, so you're willing to take low 100s for it? What do you mean? I don't know, like 100, 103, 105, something like that. No, I wouldn't do that. Oh, okay, what's the lowest you would go?
Hmm.
You don't need to be a genius to do that.
Mm-hmm.
But it's because of the senior data. I mean, if you think of it like a triangle, right?
Yeah.
If there's a triangle, right? And at the top is the peak, the senior datum is at the very top of that triangle holding all the other datums together.
Sure.
That's the senior datum, right? So if you think with senior datums, you know, like the things that get the results, then you won't have to spend all of your mental energy trying to remember everything else in that triangle.
Mm.
You'll use it when you need it, but it will come out because you had the right senior datum. It's kind of hard to explain, but that's my best shot at it, right?
Okay. I get it.
So anyways, those are my 10 traits. You've got them in two podcasts now. Hopefully they helped you. Hopefully you got something out of them. Send me a support ticket. Let me know you did or you didn't. Or make sure you subscribe to us or give us a review or go to flippinghousesforrookies.com and give us a testimonial. I will tell you that if you are not a person that has ever gone to my website or given me your email address, I strongly suggest you do that because I have some new stuff coming out that is I've outdone myself better than anything. One of which is I have a new 10-part series that it's 10 videos that you get in an email once a day for 10 days that teaches you creative real estate step by step. It goes through all the deals and explains all the deals. And I've been working on it for a month. And I think it's going to be released. Well, it's probably going to be a couple of weeks because next week I got to go over with you. But it's real close to being released. And I'm only going to release it in my email, to my email list at first. Mm-hmm. So make sure if you're not, if you haven't gone to flippinghousesforrookies.com, you go there and just download any document or get in one of my courses. Just somehow give me your email address and you will get that 10-part series. Peter, I seriously believe this is no hype. It's worth thousands of dollars, this series. I mean, I've been making videos for, and I think you know this because you're going to talk about it.
Yeah.
And they're all about 30 minutes a piece. And I just organized the most useful piece of information. If I had to start over, what would I want? And this is what I did. It's taken all these 300 and something podcasts and all my books and all my writings, and I put it all into 10 videos that are concise. So make sure you're on my email list. With that said,
Sounds good.
We are over now. Be aware that episode number 307, we're on 306, right? Yeah, 307 will be a recorded one because Pete and I will be away. So next week we will be live, but it'll be live on a recording. So there you go. All right, over and out. Thanks everybody for your support and listening, and hopefully I'll see you soon or hear from you soon.
Thanks for tuning in to the hottest real estate topics on the planet with Bill and Pete. If you want to continue learning how to buy and sell real estate without money or credit, head over to flippinghouses.club for some cutting-edge real estate wealth tools. Or contact us at info@flippinghouses.club.